for letting me be part of your war on melanoma. I'm very excited about it, and very, very happy to help out in any way that I can. I'm not going to talk about prevention or early diagnosis of melanoma. I'm going to talk a little bit more about what has become a somewhat controversial aspect of the treatment of melanoma and how much the treatment of melanoma has changed. But before I even start, I'm just going to go off script here for a second and say that once upon a time, we thought about the idea of cutting the death rate for melanoma in half in this country. And everybody, and I proposed it to many of the leaders in the melanoma world, and we all were told that was ridiculous. It was too much. Everyone will just poo-poo it and think you're not going to get anywhere. So I want to congratulate you for trying to do that, but I also want to look at what has happened in the United States. And in the last 3 years, according to the American Cancer Society estimates, the death rate in the United States has gone down 29% for melanoma. So we're already more than halfway. 2016 was the highest year, according to the American Cancer Society statistics, for deaths from melanoma, with over 10,000, and now we're at about 7,000 something this year. So it's down 29%. So we're halfway to going and cutting that down to 5,000 deaths a year, and that's still at least 4,999 too many, and we need to keep doing better. So congratulations for taking this on. By comparison, what I'm going to talk about is what do we do after it's diagnosed and how much that has also changed in just the last 3 years. I often wind up saying to my patients nowadays, I say, in the old days, 18 months ago, we'd have treated you totally differently. Okay? The last 2 or 3 years have seen enormous, enormous changes in how we even think about treating melanoma. And Dr. Vedo talked a lot about the surgical paradigm for treating melanoma in his presentation earlier today, and it's something that I agree with and think about a lot. And for many, many years, when all we had were pea shooters to take on this terrible problem of melanoma once it had become widespread, surgeons were on the front lines of the war in melanoma and were called on usually to do most of the fighting because the battles were usually lost by the time the surgeon could no longer help. So the goal of surgery was to do the most we could to improve survival, but also to do the most to achieve regional control. What does that mean? It means to never let the disease get out of control on the skin or in the lymph nodes, because we felt that if that happened, the battle had already been lost. And when you felt that way, then almost any sacrifice was justified. What were a few lymph nodes if it was life or death? And what was a swollen leg or a swollen arm or a numb armpit if you were facing a death sentence? So the motivation was entirely focused on survival. And we hoped that there would be clinical trials that would come along and it would help us get to a better state. But once the tumor recurred, we still said, can we do more surgery? What else can we do? And there was no amount of surgical side effects that we ever considered unacceptable, because the alternative was really not acceptable. So that was just literally a few years ago. And most of what has changed because the treatment options have improved. Not all, but most of it. So now there are much better treatments to prevent melanoma from coming back afterward, and there are much better treatments if the melanoma has reoccurred. So where does that leave us as surgeons at the beginning of this process? Do we still need to do a sentinel lymph node biopsy? Does it really still matter in 2019? And if it does, why? And this has become, as I said, somewhat controversial, somewhat contentious. And so let's see what we can think about and how come we want to still do sentinel node biopsies. So the reason we want to still do a sentinel node biopsy, in my opinion, is to achieve the highest survival by predicting who is at the highest risk of having their cancer come back and treating them as early as possible, and to do the best quality of life by doing the fewest lymph node dissections while still not having patients whose tumor gets out of control. Okay, so how do we get there? What can we agree on in this controversial world of management of melanoma, management of the lymph nodes? Does sentinel node biopsy still have a role to play? I think the answer is yes. I think this is our recommendation. This is the indication that we use for doing a sentinel node biopsy. We think that anybody who has a melanoma that's at least 0.8 millimeters thick in any site should have a sentinel node biopsy if their lymph nodes are negative to begin with by appearance. Now, worth mentioning that in one of the recent changes is that melanoma thickness is supposed to be talked about only to one decimal place. So 0.8 really means 0.75 and above. So if you're still used to thinking about the numbers to two decimal places, I'll be talking mostly about the numbers to just one decimal place. Why do I think we should be doing this? Well, the routine use of a sentinel node biopsy, what's it do for us? It provides reliable staging information with low rate of side effects and very few people who have a nodal recurrence if their sentinel node is negative. And it may have therapeutic value. It may actually be beneficial even if your sentinel node is positive. And I think the more sentinel nodes we remove, the fewer lymph node dissections that we will have to do. And that's a really key part of this. So let's unpack that a little bit. This is the top study, the main support for what we do with sentinel lymph node biopsy called the melanoma, the MSLT-1 study, the multicenter selective lymphadenectomy trial number one, that randomized half the patients roughly got the sentinel node, the other half did not. Okay, and just looking at the patients who did get the sentinel node biopsy, there was a big difference in the outcome if you were sentinel node negative or sentinel node positive. At 10 years, 2/3 of the patients who had a positive sentinel node were alive versus 85% of the patients who had a negative sentinel node. Now, the first thing we learn is that from those numbers is, number one, everyone with a positive sentinel node is not doomed to die from melanoma. Quite the contrary. When this study was first started in the 1990s, the idea that anybody who had melanoma in their lymph nodes could have even a 50-50 chance of survival was considered improbable. Okay, the feeling was that way more than half of the people with a melanoma in the lymph nodes, probably 3/4 or more, would be dead within 5 years. But here were 63%, almost 2/3, alive at 10 years because the melanoma was picked up earlier than we had ever been used to seeing it before. But on the other hand, and Dr. Vetto also talked about the frustration that we feel as physicians and surgeons to tell somebody, good news, your node is negative, everything looks good, and still 15% of them were dead within 10 years of melanoma. This is melanoma-specific survival, not dead of a heart attack, not dead of old age, dead of melanoma, despite everything seeming favorable. So just the sentinel node alone isn't the whole story. And maybe in the next chapter of this lecture, in a couple of years, we'll talk about what we're doing to try to improve that number too. But most of the recent efforts have been, what do we do for these sentinel node positive? If the person does get a node biopsy and does find out their node is positive, what are we doing about it? And how are we improving it? Can we improve on this number? And can we improve on the quality of the life for those patients? So when I say sentinel node biopsy reliably predicts recurrence and death at 5 or 10 years, I mean it isn't perfect. It doesn't mean that everyone who's negative is alive and everyone who's positive is dead. It means it shows the differences, and it means that we can rely on this information to make some treatment decisions as long as we recognize that it's not a death sentence or a free pass. It's a helpful marker, and it's one in a range that we as physicians and patients as well can use to make really important treatment decisions. But we also recognize that there's some value to diagnosing that melanoma early before it becomes a lump. This is the other side of that randomized study. This is if we compare the people who had a positive sentinel node, where we said 10 years survival, 63%, to what happened to the people who didn't have the sentinel node, but had the lymph nodes watched carefully by the physician and developed a lump and then had the treatment at that time. And like I said, nobody thought at that time that we could even get 50% of people with a positive node to survive 10 years. This wasn't too bad. 41% were alive after 10 years. But by comparison, that was a major, major drop-off. So earlier treatment of melanoma on the skin and in the lymph nodes makes a big difference. But the question we didn't know, because in this study, every case of a positive sentinel node had all their lymph nodes removed. So we could say, yes, that seems to improve their outcome, but how much of that improvement is due to taking out those lymph nodes, and how much could have been achieved if all we did was take out the sentinel node and stop? That was an absolutely key question that we spent years answering. But before I get into that answer, I want to make it clear, if you get to the point where the lymph node is enlarged, where it's clinically detected, where it's a lump or picked up on a CAT scan or a PET scan, we still need to remove the lymph nodes. It's still worth it, even though they're side effects of the lymph node dissection. It's still better than the alternative. So a lymph node dissection is still indicated for all patients with clinically detected positive nodes. And today, most of those patients get some form of treatment besides surgery as well. Sometimes it's radiation, sometimes it's immune therapy, sometimes it's targeted therapy. Increasingly, and I talked about this earlier this morning to the medical community, neoadjuvant systemic therapy, meaning we don't even do surgery first, we do surgery second after treatment, is increasingly being used. And one of the points that I can't make often enough, for us to really give people the best options when they have melanoma in the lymph nodes, we should be using needle biopsies to establish a diagnosis. So often we see people who have a history of melanoma, they get a lump under their arm, they go to a local doctor, and they get sent to a surgeon who just removes that lymph node and removes the chance for us to do some of the important kinds of treatment we want to use. So we're really pushing the use of needle biopsy for enlarged lymph nodes. Everyone should be able to do that. Now, I said earlier that doing a sentinel node biopsy actually lowers the number of patients who need a lymph node dissection, and I want to talk about that part a little bit more. This is, from here, in this box, is all the people on this randomized study who didn't have anything done to their lymph nodes, and they showed up back a few months or a few years later with a lump. And this is, I went the wrong way. Where did I go here? Sorry. Too technical here. And all these people needed to have their lymph nodes removed, according to my rule that anybody who has a lump has to have their lymph nodes removed. But what about the people with a positive sentinel node? What should we do for them? Do we have to do the lymph node dissection? Well, one of the reasons why we've always done those lymph node dissections is what we call medically staging, learning more about the prognosis and predicting who is most likely to be alive. And there's no question that what we learn from taking out the rest of the lymph nodes is important. The more we find in those other lymph nodes, the worse the outcome is. But now we've found that there are ways to identify the people who have the highest risk of dying with a positive sentinel node, even without a lymph node dissection. And that important parameter is the size of the metastasis in the sentinel lymph node. Even without knowing what's going on in the rest of the lymph nodes, if we know what's going on in the sentinel node itself, we learn a lot. And you see at each line here is a different thickness, measuring how big the deposit is in the lymph node. 15 millimeters or greater is the worst, but if it's very small, less than 0.2, the outcome was really good. I said it would be unusual to find a positive node that had a 50-50 chance of 10-year survival. Here's a positive node population with a 96% chance of 10-year survival because the spot in the sentinel node was so small. So today, when we see a sentinel node that has less than 0.2, we usually don't do any other treatment but remove that lymph node. When we see one that's greater than 2 millimeters, we almost always recommend treatment. And this gray zone between 0.2 and 2 is still where we have to learn a lot. And another aspect of why we want to do surgery, what we have to worry about, what we have to think about in balancing the needs of taking out the lymph nodes or keeping them in there, it's actually better from a side effect standpoint to take out the lymph nodes earlier rather than wait until later in the course of the disease. What do I mean by that? When you do the sentinel lymph node and then follow it immediately on with a complete lymph node dissection early on, rather than waiting, delaying until the lymph node can be felt, there were actually less cases of swollen arms and legs, and when they occurred, they were much less likely to be even moderate or severe swelling. Very rare for it. We would say these numbers, 12% swelling, probably even a little bit less than what we see less than that today in our patients who have a node dissection after a sentinel lymph node biopsy. So we have to get out of the idea that this is just a terrible operation, awful, shouldn't be done at all. It's appropriate to do under the right circumstances. The question is, how do we lower the side effects? So many surgeons say, well, aha, we should just be doing these lymph node dissections early on everybody. That will give the lowest side effects. And it does give lower side effects, But the lowest side effect is not doing the lymph node dissection at all if you don't need it. If the node dissection isn't absolutely necessary, we shouldn't do it because we want to have the lowest side effects without compromising the survival. And so when do we do that node dissection? Basically, some people say we should never ever do it again. And the answer is probably almost that that's correct. Not because the surgery wasn't necessary, but because our other treatments have gotten good enough. So today, a complete lymph node dissection is no longer routinely recommended for patients after a positive sentinel node biopsy. I basically haven't done one in about getting close to 2 years. And we saw 1,827 new melanomas last year, and not one of them got a completion lymph node dissection after their sentinel node biopsy. Low-risk sentinel node positive patients, the ones with just that less than 0.2 of a millimeter of melanoma in the lymph node and no other high-risk factors, do well without a complete lymph node dissection. So active nodal surveillance is an appropriate approach for them, as long as they're willing to comply with what we call an active surveillance. It's really, really important to stress that if you don't have the lymph nodes removed, it's not good. Oh, you didn't need that. Go on home. You've got to be proactive and careful. The doctor has to be following you closely. And half the time still, when there is a recurrence, not half the time overall, but of all the recurrences, half of them are still picked up by the patient themselves. And so the patient has to be part of this active surveillance approach. And for all the rest, the ones who aren't so low risk, we use treatment immediately and then watch and wait on the lymph nodes. And what we learned was that if we take this approach, then in 65% of the patients, they never needed a lymph node dissection. Absolutely didn't make any difference. We learned that in 10% of people, even doing the lymph node dissection, it didn't stop the problem. It didn't achieve the control that we wanted. So that left really just a very small group of people who eventually would benefit from a lymph node dissection. Sure, you could argue if we knew who those people were, might as well do the surgery right at the beginning, but we do not know. So if the outcome is the same, we would rather watch and wait and be carefully following to find those 25 or so percent of people who will eventually need surgery and do it appropriately. And again, here's the ones that would have had to have it if they hadn't had a sentinel node biopsy. And here, well, about 20%. But if we do it the other way around, only about 7% of all the people who have a sentinel node biopsy today will ever need a lymph node dissection. And that represents a big change in what we're used to. So for us, the sentinel node biopsy is a big part in lowering that number of people who need a lymph node dissection while maintaining the highest quality of life and still doing the most for survival. And to do better for survival, it's not with more surgery, it's not with being more aggressive surgically, it's got to be with being more aggressive with drug treatment. And so we use drug treatment for anybody who we feel at high risk. So the people who don't get any drug treatment at all are the ones with a positive sentinel node biopsy from a relatively thin primary. The melanoma is either less than a millimeter or between 1 and 2 millimeters, but not ulcerated. They have one or at most two positive lymph nodes, and they have just a small area in their lymph node of only 0.2 or less. Those people, they fall into this current stage 3A category, are the ones that just get a sentinel node biopsy and get put on active surveillance. Everybody else today is getting adjuvant therapy, meaning they're getting either immune therapy or some other form of drug therapy after their sentinel node biopsy, but only getting a node dissection after and if they develop a recurrence. So adjuvant therapy reduces the risk of both a local recurrence in the lymph nodes and of a recurrence in the lungs or elsewhere. And so we follow the lymph nodes, give adjuvant therapy, and do the lymph node dissection only when it is necessary. What do I recommend for people? What is that active surveillance? We do lymph node ultrasounds every 4 months for 3 years. It is a observer-dependent technology. You cannot look at the ultrasound afterward and reconstruct what was done, unlike a CAT scan or a PET scan. We try to get all of our patients to come back to our cancer center for their lymph node dissection. They can't all do it, but it has made a big difference. And we do it every 4 months for the first 3 years, and every 6 months for 2 years, and then annually, and we continue this for at least 10 years. We do a PET scan or a chest or a CT scan annually, and still some question, but we like to do a brain scan also annually. We actually think that's very important. When there is a localized nodal recurrence, we think it's very important. It should get a node dissection, not more drugs. And we might use drugs in addition to the node dissection, but the node dissection is not something we just don't do anymore. It's just only something we do when it's absolutely necessary. So for all the questions, I think surgery is still important in the management of node positive melanoma, but it has to have its role to play in conjunction with the many, many other weapons we now have in the war on melanoma. Once upon a time, we were trying to fight a terrible disease with a super soaker. Fortunately, we've gotten a little bit more modern, but we still have a ways to go yet before we're really where we want to be. And with that, I'll stop and thank you all for your attention.